When we flew from the Philippines, and also our flight here, but we took one of those budget flights, and we weren't so sure how much baggage allowance we had, so I counted on using a suit that I had left at my parents' place. When I got there, I realized they had emptied the room to make room for some other things, and I couldn't find my suit. So I've appreciated the loan of the jacket and a few things. But I'd like to invite you to kneel with me as we ask the Lord's blessing and presence with us. Our Heavenly Father, we are grateful for your manifold blessings, for your providences and your watch care. We thank you for the blessings that have attended this Sabbath and for the sweet fellowship and the good spiritual food that we've had. And we ask once again for the outpouring of your Spirit and for your blessing upon your servant this evening, that you will feed us with the bread of life and give us receptive hearts and minds, and we pray that we might go away from this camp meeting fed and determined to keep the blessings we have received here and not allow the enemy to come in and snatch them away. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
We've been talking about prophecy. We've gone through Daniel 7 in my studies, Daniel 7 and 8, and Revelation 13. In the other studies, we've dealt with other prophecies. Tonight, we take a look at the second part of Revelation 13, and we've entitled the message, The Mark of the Beast, because that's where it culminates. But we take it up with verse 11, which we dealt with the previous evening, Thursday evening, in our study on Revelation 13. It tells us, "And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon." We noticed that this was the United States of America. It arises at the very time that the first beast, which we saw was the papacy, went into captivity, which was 1798. At that time, this beast is arising. And so, we noticed that the previous beast arose in a populated place among nations and peoples and languages, different languages, because it arose out of the water. And water, we saw, symbolized those things. But this beast arises out of the earth, a place that was not previously inhabited by large groups of people and different nations and so forth, striving and fighting with one another. So this was a different world, the new world, they called it. This was a new place. And so we find also the description here that it has two horns like a lamb. We noticed that these were the Christian principles upon which it was based, the Republican and Protestant principles of religious freedom and civil freedom. And notice, though, that it says that he spake as a dragon. We saw in our previous study that the dragon represented Rome. The dragon represented Satan, but there was a seven-headed dragon that represented Rome there in chapter 12. And we read here in chapter 12 a little bit about that dragon. It says, And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength in the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ, for the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accuse them before our God day and night. And the context of this is this dragon. You can look at the previous verse. And it says, also when the dragon saw that he was cast unto the earth, he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man-child. So he's a persecutor. And the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed. So he's warring with the church that keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. This was the nature of the dragon. Now, a dragon, or this dragon in chapter 12, we noticed was the nation also that Satan was using, the nation of Rome. And beasts in Bible prophecy, we found in our study of chapter 7 of Daniel, represent nations. And so how does a nation, going back for a moment, how does a nation speak? But through its legislation. What kind of legislation do we find from Rome? In 321 AD, Constantine, the emperor of Rome, made a decree, on the venerable day of the sun, let the magistrates and people residing in cities rest, and let all workshops be closed. On the venerable day of the sun, they were to rest. Yeah. This was a Sunday law, a religious law. Now, it had nothing to do with a Christian observance, a Christian holy day. It was the venerable day of the sun, a pagan holy day. And this is the pagan Roman Empire represented by the dragon that was implementing this law. So how did the dragon speak? With religious legislation and persecution following. It says he exerciseth all the power of the first beast before him. So the United States is going to exercise all the power of the papacy. We saw the first beast represented the papacy. And causeth the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed. Well, what was the power exercised by the first beast? Notice, it says, Frederick II was of the same opinion. In his constitution of 1224, he says that heretics convicted by an ecclesiastical court shall on imperial authority suffer death by fire. In the bull, written in 1252, Pope Innocent IV says, when those adjudged guilty of heresy have been given up to the civil power by the bishop or his representative or the Inquisition, the podesta or chief magistrate of the city shall take them at once and shall within 5 days at the most execute the laws made against them, which was burning. So the papacy legislated laws that that there was to be a court. People were to be tried for heresy, and then they were to be given up to the civil magistrates for the execution of the sentence. And that sentence was to be punished, was to be burned, usually burned at the stake. The civil authorities, therefore, were enjoined by the popes under pain of excommunication to execute the legal sentences that condemned impenitent heretics to the stake. The power of the first beast, we can see there, was the same as the dragon's power, and that was a power over exercising over the conscience and religious legislation. So he exerciseth all the power of the first beast before him. So the United States is going to, according to prophecy, it's going to enact religious legislation, and it's going to persecute God's people. In verse 7, we read concerning the first beast that power was, it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations. So the first beast, the papacy, was given that power to overcome the saints, to make war with them, to persecute them. That's the power that the first beast exercised. So the United States is to exercise the same power. Verse 13, concerning the second beast now. He doeth great wonders, so that he maketh fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men, and deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast which had the wound by a sword and did live. So the United States, according to prophecy, is going to make an image to the beast. Not just make an image, but say to the earth, them that dwell in the earth, that they should make an image to the beast. This is going to be an international event. And something that the nations as a whole will take part in. And we have the United Nations that is an entity, an agency that could very easily be used to create this image to the beast. To understand what the image of the beast is, all we have to do is look at the beast. Because the image is going to be an image. It's going to be just like the first one. And it goes on to say, he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. So there is going to be a death sentence connected with this law, with this image of the beast. If you don't worship that image, you're going to be killed. To worship something can be done in more than one way. It doesn't necessarily mean that you have to bow down on your knees and touch your face to the floor or something. To worship we are also rendering worship if we render obedience to a power in opposition to the law of God, in opposition to God. If we put something in the place of God, the first commandment tells us what? Thou shalt have no other gods, what?
Before me.
So to put something in the place of God. And so, I don't know, you know, we have passed, in a few verses prior to this, we have passed from history now to future events. And we're still dealing with prophecy, but now the prophecy, we were looking back at the fulfillment of prophecy, and now we're looking at things that have yet to happen. The things which have happened before will strengthen us to know that the things yet to happen will yet take place. But on the plain of Dura, Nebuchadnezzar set up an image, just as we notice the United States is going to set up an image. And he commanded that everyone worship that image, just as the United States is going to do. And in all that vast multitude of people, there were only three people that stood up and refused to worship. What is it going to be like when the United States makes an image to the beast, or says to them that dwell in the earth that they should make an image to the beast, and commands everyone to worship on pain of death? These three Hebrews, they stood up tall. They didn't just kind of couch down to try to hide. They said, we're not going to worship your image. And as a result, they stirred up the anger of the king. And he threw them into the fiery furnace. But God didn't let them suffer. God didn't let them be killed. But they were willing to die. And they said, "If whether we live or die, we're not going to worship your image. It's God's prerogative. God is able to save us. But if he chooses not to, we're willing to die." The passage goes on. He causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads. What's the difference in the right hand or the forehead?
Whether they're forced or whether they do it because they want to.
That's right. One sister back here was asking about the frontal lobe, the forehead. And, you know, that's where we make decisions. That's where we think of the mind operating. Obviously, other parts of the brain can fill in, and especially with God's help and God's blessing. But the forehead signifies and symbolizes the reason versus the hand, where you can just go along with something, you can go through the forms and not really believe it. But if you receive the mark in the forehead, it signifies that you believe it.
You can be sealed.
God's seal is not acceptable if it's in the hand, is it?
That's right. Good point.
Why not? Because God wants your heart. God enlists the reason. He doesn't want you to go through the forms and the ceremonies and just count beads and say your rosary. But it says that this image to the beast and the United States here cause everyone to receive a mark. What is that mark? And that no man might buy or sell save he that had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. What is the mark? In the American Catholic Quarterly, by the way, those statements about persecution, about the results of being a heretic and so forth, those were from a Catholic website. And they were speaking of these things in a good way, as if, you know, this is great history. But this says, the Sunday as a day of the week set apart for the obligatory public worship of Almighty God, to be sanctified by a suspension of all servile labor, trade, and worldly avocations, and by exercises of devotion, is purely a creation of the Catholic Church. That is, in Christian circles, so-called professed Christian circles. We read further, the Catholic Church, by virtue of her divine mission, changed the Sabbath day from Saturday to Sunday. This is in the Catholic Mirror. These are all confessions of the Catholic Church themselves. We were, in fact, let me just pause there for a moment. We were speaking with our neighbor. I think I mentioned to you recently, or I was mentioning to someone, but she was asking us about the Sabbath. And after we explained it, she said, "Now I understand why the priest told me that the Adventists were right." Of course, the Catholic Church claims that the change of the Sabbath to Sunday was her act, and the act is a mark of her ecclesiastical power and authority in religious matters. If you want to know what God's mark is, who do you go to?
The Bible.
You go to God. You go to His Word. He'll tell you what His mark is. If you want to know what the beast's mark is, you go to the beast. What do they claim is their mark of authority? That's what they claim.
Yes.
That they changed the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday. That's what they claim is their mark.
We have the authority to do it.
The mark of the beast, an antichrist power, a power controlled by Satan,
yes,
would and must be in direct opposition to God's sign or mark. If it's anything else, it doesn't make sense. And so the fact that it's Sunday, that Sunday keeping, Sunday observance is a mark of the beast, is no surprise. Because that's the first day of the week, and there's only seven. So that's the direct opposite of the seventh day of the week, which is God's sign or seal that we saw last night. So, God wants us to understand prophecy. These things are not something you've got to have 3 or 4 degrees to understand. So, I hope these things are simple enough. We noticed this the other day. Here's wisdom, let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 600, 66. I'm going through each one of the verses so that we can see that I'm not leaving anything out. This is the description that the Bible gives, and it matches perfectly. Everything is explained. All of the symbols have their explanation. Everything has its place. We're not taking something out of context. We notice this, that I want us to be careful in our scholarly approach to the Bible. I want us to not to be careless. This doesn't say that his number, let me go back. It doesn't say that his number is 666. It's not three sixes. It doesn't use the Arabic numbers that we have, even. It says 600, 66. So let's not put this, let's not apply this where it doesn't belong. If we have three groups of sixes, I mean three sixes, let's say we have six plates, another six plates, and another six plates. That's not 600 and 66. That's how many? That's 18. Even though you have three sixes, right? It's not 666. It's 18. So neither is it the Arabic numbers. And you can twist those numbers any way you want and make any kind of configuration. That's not what it's talking about. It's talking about 666, a numerical value. So I think we need to, when we approach the scriptures and especially prophecies, we just need to be careful in our studies.